On August 1st, the post-9/11 GI Bill becomes effective. This is the most extensive education assistance program since the original GI Bill became law in 1944. Our correspondent, Ray Flores, explains how the new benefits will work.
The post-9/11 GI Bill may be hard to interpret, so to make this guide a little easier to understand, I've invited a few friends from the Department of Defense to help out.
We'll explain parts of the benefits that pertain to all service members and veterans.
And break down the really complicated parts of the new GI Bill.
And remind you of any exceptions to the rule.
First, who's eligible for the new GI Bill? We're here at the Pentagon's September 11th Memorial because there are two key numbers to remember, 9/11 and 90 days.
If you served a total of 90 days active duty service, you may be eligible for benefits if you were honorably discharged or retired.
That's whether you're active or reserve. The key is you must have at least 90 days of active duty service to qualify for the new GI Bill.
To qualify for 100% of the benefits, you must have served a total of 3 years of active duty.
And you can use it up to 15 years after your release from active service.
Let's say you got a medical discharge and served less than 90 days. You still qualify for 100% of the benefit if you served 30 days of active duty after September 10th, 2001.
But what about officers from the service academies or ROTC cadets?
Good question, Mike. So let's say you graduated from West Point. You're obligated to serve 4 years active duty to pay for the time you spent there. Your GI Bill service requirements start when you fulfilled your service academy obligations. Same goes for those who enlisted under college loan repayment.
The Montgomery GI Bill works in a point A to point B fashion. One benefit with one payment. The student pays for the school up front.
And the government paid the student about $1,300 a month for a full-time course load.
The post-9/11 GI Bill is significantly different. Now students get three benefits instead of one. The first is that the student, in this case Liz, doesn't have to come up with the money for tuition. Now the schools receive their tuition directly from the government.
And the government has a cap on how much they will pay. The way the policy reads is the cost of tuition and fees must not exceed the most expensive in-state undergraduate tuition at a public institution of higher education, which can sound confusing.
Okay, what does this mean to you? Between Ray and I is the border between Virginia and Washington, D.C. I'm going to school in D.C., and Ray's going to school in Virginia.
According to the GI Bill website, I am eligible for a maximum of $313 per credit hour and $3,660 in school fees.
And because my school is on this side of the bridge, I receive a maximum of $105 per hour and $665 in fees.
But be careful, because if you're getting a graduate degree or attending a private university, the post-9/11 GI Bill will only pay the maximum in-state undergraduate tuition, unless you're at a school like George Washington University that participates in the Yellow Ribbon program.
As Mike said, because of its location in D.C., the post-9/11 GI Bill will pay a maximum of $105 an hour and $657 in fees. But the actual cost of classes here is $1,157 per hour. As you can see, the difference is $1,052. It's a lot of bank to make up while you're trying to go through school.
By joining the Yellow Ribbon program, George Washington has agreed to pay half of the difference. And the VA agrees to match what George Washington pays, which means the student veteran pays nothing.
But remember, not all private institutions are part of the Yellow Ribbon program. Check out the post-9/11 GI Bill website at gibill.va.gov to see which schools have signed up.
And that's the first benefit of the new legislation. The second benefit is a housing allowance. Students receive a monthly housing allowance equal to a military E-5 with dependents.
That's according to the school zip code, not where you live.
And this is a big exception. If you're like Mike here and you're currently on active duty, you do not qualify for the housing allowance. You also don't qualify for the housing allowance if you're only taking online classes or taking a half a course load or less.
Why is this substantial? Consider if you were going to school here in Washington, D.C. or Northern Virginia. Your housing allowance would be $1,917 extra a month. That's a lot of part-time work you won't have to worry about while you're trying to educate yourself.
We all know the cost of books and supplies can begin to add up. The third new benefit is full-time students receive up to $1,000 per year for books and supplies.
And there is also a $500 stipend available to those who live in rural areas.
The new legislation might offer substantial benefits, but is it right for every qualified veteran? Ray Flores and his team return to answer that question and to take a look at how the new spouse and dependent transfer option works.
Remember, signing up for the post 9/11 GI Bill is permanent. You can't switch back to the Montgomery GI Bill if you figured out it's not the best for you financially or for your educational goals.
So we're going to try to give you some of the facts so you can make the best decision. First, what does the post 9/11 GI Bill cover?
The new benefit covers an undergrad degree, including vocational and technical training. Or if you're like me and already have a bachelor's, it includes your master's or PhD.
But a big difference between the new benefit and, say, the Montgomery GI Bill is that all approved training must be offered by an institute of higher learning. What that really means is any college or university.
How does that affect you? Well, if you wanted to use your education benefit to go to flight school or to culinary school, if that training isn't held at an institute of higher learning, the post 9/11 GI Bill might not be the best fit for you.
Even though the post 9/11 GI Bill offers great benefits, in some cases it's not the best fit for the student. VA has posted some case studies online so you can educate yourself. For instance, if a full-time student wants or needs to only take online classes because that student does not qualify for the housing allowance, it can be a financially sound choice to keep the Montgomery GI Bill.
One of the most significant benefits of the post 9/11 GI Bill is the ability to transfer your education to your immediate family. The policy is not set in stone yet, but we can provide you the gist of how this will work.
First, you must be eligible for the post 9/11 GI Bill. But if you separated or retired from the military before August 1st, 2009, you are not eligible to transfer your benefits.
Say Liz is new to the Navy. To qualify, Liz must have at least 6 years of military service to be eligible to transfer her benefits.
And I have to agree to re-enlist for an additional 4 years.
Then there are people like Michael in the middle of their careers. If he has at least 10 years of service and can't serve an additional 4 years because of a service policy.
Say I can't re-enlist for 4 years because I didn't get promoted fast enough. Then I qualify. But I do have to agree to serve the maximum time that policy will allow.
And for those about to retire?
The rules differ depending on your separation date.
Those eligible can transfer all or part of their benefits to either their spouse or their children in any combination. You can find the latest on the GI Bill transfer policy at the Department of Defense GI Bill website.
We hope you've gained a basic understanding of how the post 9/11 GI Bill works.
And remember, there are a lot of online resources available to help educate yourself.
For most veterans who served in uniform after September 11, 2001, the post 9/11 GI Bill will help you pay for your education at colleges and universities around America.
For Petty Officer Liz Murray, Gunnery Sergeant Steve Williams, Sergeant First Class Michael Bryan, and Stephen Smith, reporting from our nation's capital, I'm Ray Flores.
As you've just heard, the new GI Bill covers most, if not all, tuition costs at public in-state colleges.